This morning we're going to be looking at a promise our Lord Jesus Christ gives to us in Matthew chapter 21. I'd like to begin reading this passage from verse 18 rather than verse 19. Whether it's on the screen or not doesn't really matter that much, but the verse we're going to focus on is in this reading in verse 22. This is the example our Lord Jesus gave to his disciples. You might say a visual example of the power of faith. If we trust the Lord and believe what it is that he has promised he will give to us. And it has to do with the cursing of this fig tree. This is what we read in verse 18 of Matthew 21. Now in the morning when he was returning to the city, he became hungry. Seeing a lone fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves only. And he said to it, "No longer shall there ever be any fruit from you." And at once the fig tree withered. Seeing this, the disciples were amazed and asked, "How did the fig tree wither all at once?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, 'Be taken up and cast into the sea,' it will happen. And all things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." That's a tremendous promise, and I'm hoping the Lord will give to us grace to be able to appropriate it today. And I'm not going to focus so much on certain aspects of this passage that have to do with whether or not God wants the mountain moved. We don't see very many mountains moving, which means that either God's people don't have faith, or maybe the Lord doesn't want the mountains to be moved. We do need to remember that when we ask the Lord for things, they need to be things that he wants done, things for his glory, not just to show off the power of faith, as it were, by, you know, casting mountains into the ocean. That could actually be quite dangerous for the coastal cities. But anyway, let's take a look at what our Lord is actually saying here. Now, last week, just by way of reminder, we heard our Lord call us to put his kingdom first, to put his concerns first in our lives, before everything else, before the things in this world that he gives us to enjoy. He says even before the necessities of life, our necessary food and covering, to be different than the people of this world, because this is exactly what they're concerned about. What am I going to eat? What am I going to drink? What am I going to have? And what can I enjoy in this world? How can I bring myself more pleasure? The world seeks after pleasure from the things of the world. But the Lord tells us that we need to seek our pleasure in him. We need to put him first and not ourselves. Now, we saw that putting his kingdom first means that if we don't know him, that we need to turn to him. That's where it begins. We must turn from everything that is in our lives that dishonors him. We must trust him to save us. We must place our whole hope of getting to heaven upon him. We need to put him first with regard to our hope of heaven. It means, second, of course, having done this, that we are to set our hearts upon him. That Jesus is to be the very center of our lives. He is to be the treasure that is hidden in the field for us. He is to be the pearl of great price to us, the one that we are willing to deny ourselves for, the one that we're willing to give up everything and to sell all that we have for in order that we might have him. He is the one that we are to follow, no matter how difficult it might be, because we see in him that worthiness, that glory, that beauty that sets him apart from everything else. Nothing else is even to compare. Now, it meant, thirdly, of course, that we must follow him according to the directions that he lays out for us in his word. that we shouldn't go by our desires, we shouldn't go by opportunity, but rather we should allow the Lord's Word to guide us as He guides us by His Holy Spirit. Remember, we saw that God gives us His Spirit. That's why Jesus came into the world. I made mention a little bit earlier, you know, the Father, out of His great love, gives His Son. He gives the price, He pays the price that is necessary in order to purchase for us a gift that is greater than anything the world has to offer, and that is the Holy Spirit. And He freely gives us the Holy Spirit so that we might be able to appropriate, receive everything that the Lord has for us, which is far greater, far more glorious than anything the world has to give. He has freely given to us His Holy Spirit, and His Spirit was given to us to comfort us, to teach us, and to guide us. But remember, the Spirit doesn't do this, as it were, apart from the Word. He does it through the Word. We can't trust what our feelings tell us, what our desires tell us, because we have two desires within our souls. We have the desires after the things of the world because of our flesh, but we also have desires after the kingdom of heaven because of His Holy Spirit. So how do we distinguish between those two desires? But by the Word, the Spirit will confirm it through the Word. We also can't trust the open doors that the Lord sets before us to guide us, because He opens two kinds of doors. And whenever He opens a door, it's always, of course, by His grace, but there are those doors that He does want us to walk through, doors of opportunity for service and to give Him glory. But there are also doors of testing to see whether or not we're going to go that direction, to try our faith. And sometimes He opens even, you know, doors of difficulty. Now, every door that opens is opened by Him, but He doesn't intend for us necessarily to go through every one, particularly not those doors of temptation. Again, the Lord is in sovereign control of everything that happens in this world. So when we are confronted by temptation, even that was put there by Him. But He doesn't intend for us necessarily to walk through that door, but rather not to walk through that door. So how do we know which doors to go through and which doors not to go through? How are we going to know which are for our good and which not, and which are for our greater good? Well, again, it's only through the Word that God shows us which way to go. I would remind you again, Calvin, when he was in Geneva talking with Farrell, he had two doors open before him. He could stay in Geneva or he could go to Strasbourg, which is what he wanted to do. And if he went to Strasbourg, it wasn't to avoid serving the Lord, but it was to serve Him in Strasbourg, living the quiet life of a scholar. He realized to stay in Geneva would mean a great deal of difficulty. But yet, it was the door that he knew that he had to go through, especially after William Farrell told him that God's going to curse your work in Strasbourg if you abandon us now and you go there and seek to live a quiet life there. And so Calvin heard the voice of God. He stayed in Geneva and he faced great difficulty, but he also did a great deal of good for the kingdom of heaven. I would say that Calvin is rejoicing now in heaven, because by God's grace, he took the more difficult road. And the reason why is not because it was more difficult, but because it gave greater glory to God and therefore resulted in greater reward to himself. So we need the Spirit of God to guide us, but we also need the Word of God. God does open doors of opportunity for us, but we need to make sure that we're passing through the doors that God wants us to, and we need to make that distinction through the Word of God. If we are to put the kingdom of heaven first, we need to make the same kind of choices that Calvin did and that the people of God did in the Scriptures. And if we do, by God's grace, remember the Lord says, we will not lose anything. I mean, life may be a little bit more difficult in this life, but we will gain everything. If we put the kingdom of heaven first, God says He will provide for our needs. He will protect us. He will work all of our circumstances out for good, and He will give to us a reward in heaven that we will never lose. Whatever we gain in this world, we leave behind, but whatever we gain for the kingdom of heaven, we get to keep. Now this morning, let's consider something else that we need to put His kingdom first that will not only help us make the right kind of choices, but help us to see good results from the choices that we do make, and that is faith. Again, I remind you what Jesus says in Matthew 21, verse 22. All things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. We need faith if we are to receive what the Lord has promised to help us in seeking the kingdom of heaven. Now, first of all, let's consider what we mean by faith. And we're just going to take a couple of moments on this because I think we all know. The author to the Hebrews defines it in this way in Hebrews 11, verse 1. He says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. It is the assurance, the conviction, the certainty that we will receive what it is that we have asked for, the things that God has promised to give us, because God is faithful, because God is trustworthy, because God is worthy to be believed and worthy to be trusted. Now, we're going to focus on that a bit more this evening, on why it is that God gives us these promises and why it is we can trust Him to fulfill His promises. But for right now, I just want to simply call our attention to a couple of things that show us that we can trust Him. The first thing is that the God that we worship and the God who has made these promises is infinitely holy and infinitely righteous. He is a God who cannot lie. He will not lie. It is contrary to His nature. There is no lie in Him. Satan, as you know, is exactly the opposite. He is the father of lies, and all he speaks are lies. But God, when He speaks, tells us the truth. What God says, God will do. And if He makes a promise, Jesus says, if you ask for that, He'll give it to you. You can believe it. Now, secondly, He's also infinitely powerful. He will not only do what He says, He can do what He says. And both of these add up to trust. Okay? If anybody else makes a promise, we don't know whether that promise is going to actually come to pass or not, whether they're going to fulfill it or not, but we do know that when Jesus makes a promise, He keeps that promise because He cannot do otherwise. Now, secondly, Jesus tells us, though, that we must believe if we're going to receive what is promised. We must have faith that God can do it and that He will do it. What we ask. He says in our passage, all things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. And I want you to notice that Jesus always says, when He's talking about fulfilled promises, that the recipient must always trust Him, must always believe. Now, we have to believe that He is able to do it for us. We've already seen why He's able to do it, but it's important that we believe that He is able. We read in Matthew 9, verses 28 through 30. When He entered the house, the blind men came up to Him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" They said to Him, "Yes, Lord." Then He touched their eyes, saying, "It shall be done to you according to your faith." And their eyes were opened. We have to believe He is able to actually fulfill the promises that He has made to us when we ask. Now, if we don't believe, or I should say, first of all, if our faith is weak, if we're not convinced that the Lord is able, we also have clear evidence from Scripture that it will limit what the Lord is actually willing to do for us. Not what He is able to do. There's no limitations on His ability. But I think there is a limitation on what He is willing to do for us if we don't believe. Now, we read later on in Matthew 13, verses 54 through 58. He came to his hometown and began teaching them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, "Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And his brothers, James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? And they took offense at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and in his own household. And he did not do many miracles there because of their unbelief. Now, Jesus says we must believe that he's able to do what we ask him to do. We must ask believing. And if we don't, it does hinder what it is he is willing to do. And of course, it goes without saying that if we don't believe at all, that we will receive nothing from him at all. If we don't have faith, there is no guarantee of any willingness on his part. Although sometimes the Lord does do good things for people who don't believe, there's no guarantee. As a matter of fact, there is the guarantee that if we don't trust, if we doubt, we won't receive anything. He tells us through James, in James 1, verses 5 through 8. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him, but he must ask in faith, without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. So faith is a conviction, it is a certainty that God is going to do what it is he promised he would do. When you ask that he will give it to you, you need to have that kind of certainty. You need to have that faith to believe, because if you don't, then you will not receive. We will not receive from the Lord. With it, he will give us everything that he has promised. So thirdly, how can we have faith? How can we believe that the Lord is going to do this for us? Well, the good news is that if we have trusted Jesus this morning, we already have the requisite faith. I mean, after all, how is it that we were actually saved? Salvation is by grace through faith. We were saved by God's grace alone. Remember, Jesus is the one who did everything. He's the one who came into this world to live for us. He's the one who died on the cross for us. He's the one who was buried and rose again from the dead. He's the one who ascended into heaven. And he did all of these things for us who believe in him. He freely offered to save us. And the way we received what it is he did was by faith. By faith alone. We believe that he was able. We believe that he was willing to give us what he promised. And so we looked to him. We trusted him. And we received the promised grace. Now let me ask you this question. How is that any different from believing and receiving anything else that the Lord actually has promised to give us? It really isn't, because the Lord held out to us a promise. If you repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. And by faith, we embrace the Lord Jesus Christ. We trusted him to fulfill that promise, and we received the promised blessing. But that's exactly how we receive everything that the Lord promises to give us. See, if we've trusted Jesus, we already have faith, the faith we need to receive his promises. But fourthly, we've already seen that even though we have faith, faith can be weaker or faith can be stronger. Now, if we have any faith at all by God's grace in the Lord Jesus Christ, then we have what we need to receive his grace, because salvation does not depend on the strength of our faith. It depends really on the reality of our faith, that we have any faith at all. The Puritan John Rogers writes this. He says, weak faith is true faith, as precious, though not so great as strong faith. The same Holy Ghost the author, the same gospel the instrument, for it is not the strength of our faith that saves, but the truth of our faith. Not the weakness of our faith that condemns, but the lack of faith. When it comes to salvation, thankfully, all we need is faith, and even a weak faith, if it is a true faith, in the Lord Jesus is enough to save us. But one thing I'd point our attention to here is that even though a weak faith can save, it's still not enough to receive all that the Lord might give to us, to enable us to do all that the Lord might want to do through us. Let me again read for you another example where a lack of faith can actually hinder us from doing what the Lord calls us to do. And it's this example in Matthew chapter 17, verses 14 through 20, where the disciples were not able to cast out a demon because they did not have enough faith. Matthew writes, "When they came to the crowd, a man came up to Jesus, falling on his knees before him and crying, 'Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and is very ill. For he often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him.' And Jesus answered and said, 'You unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him here to me.' And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured at once. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, 'Why could we not drive it out?' And he said to them, 'Because of the littleness of your faith. For truly I say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, "Move from here to there," and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you.'" I think that's an interesting statement. Now, Jesus here, by this phrase, littleness of faith, basically means inadequate. It's one word in the original language that says the disciples did not have enough faith. Their faith was not strong enough. A.T. Robertson, the well-known Greek scholar, points out the conclusion that Jesus drew: their faith was less than a grain of mustard seed. Jesus said, if you have even that much faith, you can move mountains, and nothing will be impossible to you. So the implication is that the faith they had was even smaller than that. And remember, a mustard seed is the smallest seed in the garden. It's enough to be saved by God's grace, but not enough to move mountains or to cast out demons or to receive everything that the Lord has to give us. Notice Jesus said, nothing will be impossible for you. So the question we'll ask fifthly is, how can we have a stronger faith? We may be believers. We may have genuine faith and trust in the Lord. But how are we going to have the kind of faith that is going to be able to, as it were, receive everything the Lord wants to give us, particularly as we set out to serve Him in His kingdom? Well, we need, of course, to nurture the faith we have. If we don't have any faith, we need to come to the Lord Jesus. That's square one. If we have no faith, only Jesus can give it. We need to go to Him. We need to ask Him for faith. But if we have faith, we need to nurture that faith. And here's a couple of things we can do. First of all, the most obvious is to use the different ways that God gives to us to strengthen our faith. We do need to read the Word of God. We need to pray. We need to fellowship. We need to serve. And I think the Word and prayer are particularly important. Remember, the Spirit of God actually uses the Word of God to create faith. Paul writes in Romans 10, verse 17, "So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the Word of Christ." There's people throughout the world who do not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and if they are to believe, Paul tells us in Romans 10 that we need to go to them and tell them the gospel. That's the reason why we do missions. That's the reason why we do evangelism. God is not going to save them in a vacuum. He's not just going to zap them as they're walking along the road and suddenly they're going to believe, unless the gospel has first come to them. If they haven't heard it, there is not going to be faith. He uses the Word. The Spirit of God works through the Word. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. But He uses the Word not only to create faith, He uses it to strengthen faith. It is spiritual food for our souls. In the Word of God, we see what it is that God has promised. We see many examples of those who believed God and who actually acted on that faith, did what the Lord called them to do, and they saw the Lord's faithfulness in answering those prayers. We see that He will give to those who believe in His Word. And the Spirit of God working through the Word of God assures us that God will also give us what it is He has promised if we will simply trust Him. But He uses the Word of God to build us up in faith. Now, prayer is also important. Prayer is worship, it's adoration, it's confession, it's all those things, but it's also supplication. It's asking God for things. Why do we ask God for things? Because He's made a promise to us to give us those things. If we ask and we believe at some level that He's going to do it, and so we ask Him, it is a way that we exercise our faith. And as we exercise it, it is strengthened. Because of what Jesus said on this one occasion, which we've already read in our other text in Matthew 7, verses 7 through 8, He says, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened." Now, you and I know that this is true. Jesus said it, and we know He does not lie. We have the faith to believe this. And so, as we ask, and as we receive, as we see the Lord answer, it causes our faith to grow. It really does. We need to be in the Word more so that we'll know what to pray for more, that we may see God work more, and that we may have more of the influence of the Holy Spirit that will give us a stronger faith. The Spirit of God strengthens our faith. Seeing prayers answered strengthens our faith. But we need to do the things that strengthens our faith. And we need to ask. Jesus actually, you know how there's different kinds of statements in Scripture. This is not really a statement. When Jesus says, ask, He's actually issuing us a command. He's telling us, ask. I mean, what more do we need, right? Jesus is commanding us to ask for the things that we need, and He says, if you'll just simply obey that, I will give it to you. Everyone who asks, receive. Why aren't we asking? We need to ask, and as we ask and receive, again, our confidence in the Lord grows. Just look back over your own lives and see how the Lord has already answered your prayers, how He's taken care of you. I mean, you're alive here today, aren't you? You're here. We're all breathing. We all enjoy relative health. The Lord has taken care of us. He has protected us. We know that He is faithful and that He can be trusted to do what He said He would do. It's been over a year ago that we saw that documentary on the life of George Mueller, but it still stays with me. I don't think that Mueller, when he first started out in the Christian life and began serving the Lord and in ministering to those orphans, I don't think his faith was as strong then as it was at the end of his life. I think that as he trusted God in the small matters and he saw God's faithfulness, that his faith grew. He was taught to trust the Lord in much greater ones. And again, remember how Jesus, we just saw him or heard him say that nothing will be impossible for you? I think George Mueller is an example of that, isn't it? Because that prayer in the hold of the ship and how the fog dissipated so quickly. Would we have the faith to believe that that could happen? That God would ever do that? And yet he was fully convinced that God would do that. And God did it because he believed God was willing to do it. But I think where we fail, of course, is that our faith is not as strong as Mueller's. We need to have a stronger faith, and the Lord has given us the ability or the ways in which to gain that faith. We need to walk step by step with Him and trust Him. See Him answer the small things and know that He is faithful in the greater as well. Now, finally, let's look at one last point. The importance of having a strong faith if we are going to be used in God's kingdom as we would like to be used. And I'm sure this speaks to all of us, because we would all want to be used more than the Lord is currently using us. Now, how does faith work into this? Well, obviously, why would we ever put the kingdom first unless we actually believed it exists? You know, even the strongest believer sometimes doubts what God says in His Word is true. The stronger our faith, the more real these things will appear to us. Now, they're real whether we see them or not, but we will see them as they are more clearly. They are real. How will we be able to put it first unless we believe that this is actually what Jesus calls us to do? Faith is what convinces us that what the Lord says in His Word is true. Jesus, our Lord who is seated in heaven, has already told us, "Put my kingdom first." Faith is what allows us to hear that, to know it's true, that that is what He commands us to do, and actually to put it first. How is the Lord going to give us these things? How are we going to appropriate the help that the Lord has promised unless we believe that He has made these promises and that He actually will give these things to us if we ask? Well, faith shows us what the Lord has put at our disposal. Spurgeon writes this: "The boundless stores of providence are engaged for the support of the believer. Christ is our Joseph, who has granaries full of wheat. But He does not treat us as Joseph did the Egyptians, for He opens the door of His storehouse and bids us call all the good therein our own. He has entailed upon His estate of providence a perpetual charge of a daily portion for us. And He has promised that one day we shall clearly perceive that the estate itself has been well farmed on our behalf and has always been ours. The axle of the wheels of the chariot of providence is infinite love, and gracious wisdom is the perpetual charioteer." I mean, do we really believe that God has not only made these promises, but they actually belong to us in the Lord Jesus? That all of these treasures, as it were, that He has stored up are ours, and that it is His pleasure to give them to us, that God actually rejoices when we ask and believe so that He can give us these things? Now, without faith, how are we going to know these things belong to us? How do we know God's going to give them to us? And how do we know that God is going to do what He promised that He was going to do, even though the Lord will test our faith? He will put it to the test. I mean, I like to believe, and sometimes it is the case, I suppose, that you ask and the Lord immediately answers. And I mean, He did certainly George Mueller on that occasion, but not always. There were times at the beginning of Mueller's ministry, remember, he prayed and God supplied. And they had storehouses full. And it was easy to trust the Lord as long as their storehouses were full. But eventually the storehouses became empty and they had no food when it came to mealtime. And they prayed and God provided at the moment that they needed it and didn't give a store, as it were, in advance. There are times when it seems like the Lord is actually working against what He has promised. And I think it comes as a challenge to us to see whether or not we're going to trust Him to the end, even though circumstances seem to go against it. Thomas Watson writes this: "God is to be trusted when His providences seem to run contrary to His promises. God promised David to give him the crown, to make him king. But providence turns contrary to His promise. David was pursued by Saul, was in danger of his life, but all this while it was David's duty to trust God. The Lord does oftentimes by cross providence bring to pass His promise. God promised Paul the lives of all that were with him in the ship, but now the providence of God seems to run quite contrary to His promise. The winds blow, the ship splits and breaks in pieces, and thus God fulfilled His promise upon the broken pieces of the ship. they all come safe to shore. Trust God when providence seems to run quite contrary to promises. I think you know what he's talking about here, right? I mean, the idea is God promises David he's going to be king. Well, it's great, God, so when do I get to go to the throne? Well, first of all, Saul has to chase you through the wilderness and try to kill you. Your son's going to turn, well, actually that happened later, but all these things are going to come against you. And yet, is what God said any less true? David still believed the promise, and he received the promise. Same thing with the ship. Here's this great storm. God says to Paul, I'm going to spare all the lives of those in the ship, but you have to stay in the ship. But what happens is they come comfortably to shore in the wind, to shore in the storm. No, the storm broke the ship into pieces, and they all came to shore on pieces of the boat. And yet the Lord still fulfilled his promise. Just because he's going to fulfill it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. He's going to put our faith to the test. The question is, are we going to continue to believe? Without faith, how can we be convinced that the Lord is going to work everything that we have to endure in his service for our ultimate good? Again, Watson writes this, to know that nothing hurts the godly is a matter of comfort, but to be assured that all things which fall out shall cooperate for their good, that their crosses shall be turned into blessings, that showers of affliction water the withering root of their grace and make it flourish more, this may fill their hearts with joy till they run over. How would you ever even think that's going to happen unless you actually believe what God says, that he is going to work all things together for your good? As a matter of fact, it's going to be good that you go through that affliction because of the blessing God's going to bring. Without faith, how can we know that when we set our hearts to serve him in his kingdom, that we're not simply running a fool's errand in giving our lives in his service? Well, faith is what shows us that there is a glorious future. There is a reward ahead of us for the sacrifices that we make for the Lord here. Again, that's the reason why I pointed to Matthew 13, the parable of the kingdom. The disciples may have thought, what was Jesus talking about when he said this kingdom was going to become a great tree? They may not have seen it, but it was still true. And then they began to see revival, and then they began to be encouraged. Yes, what Jesus said is true. So even though it seems like things are going against it, we still need to trust that God is true and he will fulfill his purposes. But to do that, we need faith. We need a strong faith. If we are to overcome our flesh, if we're to overcome the world, if we're to overcome the attacks of the enemy, that we might be used by God to advance his kingdom. Now again, the point is this, that God has made it possible for us to have this kind of faith. He graciously created this faith in us. He's given us the means to strengthen it. He has shown us again and again that we can trust him in everything. So let's be encouraged this morning to set aside all of our doubts and the worries that we often fall into as we look around at the circumstances, like Peter did on that one occasion. He trusted Jesus to get out of the boat and begin walking to him, but then he began to look at the circumstances rather than at the Lord. And he became afraid and he began to sink. Let's lay aside our doubts. Lay aside our worries. Let's trust in the Lord. Believe him. Believe his promises. And let's press forward. Satan, our flesh, the world would try to come against us, to stop us. And it's very effective at doing that in a variety of ways. But one of them, again, is doubt and worry. Let's learn to trust the Lord. Remember, he gave his son to seal these promises to us. Just how serious is God in fulfilling his promises to us? The table shows us. He was willing to give us his son. And how will he not, with his son, then give us all things? Let's learn from this example to trust the Lord. Let's bow in a moment of prayer and let's think about what the Lord is actually saying through the table this morning. and how when he said his promises are yes and amen in the Lord Jesus, what that means. He is willing to do all that he promised. The fact that he was willing to give us his son to save us proves it. Let's spend a few moments in prayer.